Regular meeting of council for Tuesday, September the 5th in the City Hall Council Chambers. I'd like to call this meeting to order and first recognize that we are on the traditional territory of the Sechot and Hupachasit First Nation. Council, any late items? City Clerk, any late items?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, we have under F3.1 a tender award, G1.1 a letter regarding the proposed Latham Road lane closure, and as already noted on your agenda package, the McLean Mill monthly report has been distributed.
Thank you. Council, we need to approve the agenda as circulated with the addition of late items as outlined.
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Seconder?
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. Council, before we begin the next part of our agenda, I just have some historical notes. This is the year, as we know, that Port Alberni and Alberni amalgamated 50 years ago to form the amalgamated city of Port Alberni. And in recognition of the 50th anniversary of the 1967 amalgamation of the cities of Alberni and Port Alberni, the Alberni Valley Museum, on the recommendation of the Alberni Valley Heritage Commission, has prepared these historical notes. They are for presentation at Port Alberni City Council meetings during the months of September and October, in the lead up to the actual amalgamation date of October 28th. These notes offer a snapshot of what was going on 50 years ago as the Twin Cities prepared for amalgamation in 1967. The information comes from 1967 editions of the West Coast Advocate and the Twin Cities Times, as well as other documents from the Alberni District Historical Society Community Archives. In early September 1967, Alberni and Port Alberni were gearing up to celebrate the coming amalgamation, as well as Canada's centennial. The Centennial Amalgamation Committee, which included representatives from both city councils, the Parks and Recreation Commission, and the community at large, was in charge of preparing for and promoting the festivities. At the Fall Fair, which took place from September 7th to 9th, the committee had a booth dedicated to informing citizens of progress being made through the city and on amalgamation. Fall Fair attendance set a record that year, with 9,842 tickets sold, plus thousands of school children and others with passes who attended. In honor of the amalgamation of the Albernis and Canada's centennial, several new public buildings were built or under construction. By September, Echo Centre, as yet unnamed, was almost ready to open after many months of work. Parks and Recreation was calling for applications for full and part-time swimming instructors and lifeguards and preparing for the opening of the new pool. In other local news, a 47-pound, 12-ounce Tai salmon won the Open Derby hosted by the Alberni Valley Tai Club at the Port Alberni Marina on Monday, September 4th, 1967. The MB Hootentoot, featuring Keith Rogers and Jack Whittall, had its first show on CJV on Thursday, September 7th, 1967. It was advertised as an all-new, all-different radio program dedicated to McMillan Bloedel employees and their families, neighbors, friends, and relations, reflecting how central the company was in the Twin Cities. Next council meeting, we'll bring you some more information. Okay, thank you, everybody. Council, we have the minutes in front of us of the regular council meeting held at 2 p.m. and the special meeting held at 6:20 p.m. on August 14th, 2017. A motion to adopt those minutes, please.
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. This brings us to our public input period. It's an opportunity for public to address council on topics of relevance to city council. Maximum of four speakers for no more than 3 minutes each will be accommodated. Anybody wish to address council? Yes, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Under question period and unfinished business, When a resident addresses an issue during question period and council isn't able to give a response at that time, they respond at the next meeting under unfinished business. Question period is the second last item on the agenda. I believe it's about 14th. Unfinished business is fourth. If a resident is willing to sit through a meeting to ask questions, it seems unfair that at the next meeting, when a response is given to their question under unfinished business, they should then be required to sit through the next meeting until the question period to address any questions regarding the city's response. This is not conducive both to encouraging better turnouts at meetings, and in a way, although I know it's not meant this way, is disrespectful to community members that take the time to participate in the city business. My request is that under unfinished business, a person who may have the need or want have the opportunity to ask questions of the response if they ask the question initially. Second, technology. Computers are, of course, a great asset in the running of the business of the city. However, there is a downside. Cities promote the use of emails as a means of enhancing communication between council staff and the public taxpayers. One element is left out in the communication between the members and the public. An email, for example, is between a writer and the receiver, and the public may never be aware of what concerns or suggestions that come from the emails. The public are not aware. An example is the issue I brought up about the track. If I hadn't brought that up after the city did 2 months prior, it probably would not be an issue with some people today. Personally, I want to know how the community feels about issues and the city's response to their input, and not on Facebook. That is why question period should be an important part of the agenda. I have never heard a city council take the time to sincerely encourage people to come to meetings and express themselves in the public forum. In fact, I believe at times councils, and I'm not directing this at this council, I'm talking generally speaking, prefer it if few people stand up during question period and justify it by solely promoting communication through the computers. Like, don't come to the meetings, you have access at any time that you want. There's something missing. People openly sharing their feelings as to what the direction of our community should go. My concern is, as valid as these modes of communication are, it will in time exclude or be used to exclude open dialogue between the city and the public. And I just really like to see more efforts being made to get people out of these meetings, as hard as it is. And I'm not saying these other modes aren't justified. This is where they should be. And exchange your ideas with the community, not with individual members of council or staff. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Anderson. And
Robert Webster.
Okay, Robert, please come forward.
This is what happened when I tried to report dog attacks. The last dog attack was 2 weeks ago. My 5-year-old granddaughter was present. That was attack number 9. Make sure everyone gets a copy. This is what happened when the RCMP got involved.
Sorry, Mr.
Yes.
Sorry, Mr. Webster, could we just get your address?
4067 Compton Road East.
Okay, thank you.
This is what happened when the RCMP got involved. I was cleared of all charges. The complaints against me were false. The officers that were involved were reprimanded. Make sure everyone gets a copy. The resolution is in there too. Here's two pictures of what the municipal yards did when they got a hold of my address, which is private and personal information and should have never been passed on to them. My mother's 80 years old when these pictures were taken. She's a diabetic, she was fasting since the night before, and she couldn't get out of her driveway because of where your snow plows had piled the snow in front of them. You can have a look at it and see if you find any humor in it like your city municipal yard did. When I left, they weren't laughing, and I didn't have to tell them my address in order for them to go and clear it before I got home. That's it, someone else can have the rest of my time. Thank you.
Okay.
Oh, I use a cane, 24 years in the Canadian Armed Forces, retired senior non-commissioned officer. No one has ever questioned my honesty or integrity except for him. Never happens again. You got that? Phone my mother and apologize.
Hi, Mr. Mayor.
Phone my mother and apologize.
Take that type of abuse from the mic.
Okay, thank you. Don't believe there's anybody else who wishes to address council. This brings us, council, to D, delegations. Yes.
Sorry to interrupt, but I just noticed, to Mr. Anderson's point, the live stream actually isn't on for our council meeting right now. I don't know if there's something going on in the back, but.
How would you notice that?
I popped it up.
Oh.
I've already been.
I have already been notified, Mr. Mayor, that there is an issue and they are working on it.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. All right. Ms. Tremblay.
Oui. Mr. Mayor and members of council, I am pleased tonight to be able to introduce you to our new Director of Parks, Recreation and Heritage, Willa Thorpe. Willa started with the city last week, and she brings with her an extensive background in recreation and community services, most recently working for the city of Prince Rupert. So Willa and her family have relocated to Port Alberni, and we're excited to welcome her to our community. I don't know if any of you have any questions for Willa, or just an introduction.
Willa.
Come on up, Willa.
Like the dog and pony show?
Or? Yes. Well, welcome to Port Alberni.
Thank you.
I'm glad that you chose to relocate from Prince Rupert to here. I don't know whether you spent even 1 second looking at the weather in Prince Rupert this summer, but it wasn't quite the same as it has been here in Port Alberni, but I guess that's often the way.
Yeah, it sort of felt like November, leaving Prince Rupert, so it's pleased. I'm not sure if I'm so pleased yet to see we're breaking the heat records from Alberni, but it's been gorgeous.
It has been. I apologize for the smoke, but it's the way it is. Hopefully by tomorrow, the weatherman will have confirmed that it's going to be out of here.
Welcome.
So, welcome to Port Alberni.
Thank you.
To your new position as director of our Parks and Rec. It's a big job, and I'm sure you're going to be fully occupied, as you probably already have this first week.
Yes, yeah, so far so good. It's been great.
All right. So, thank you very much. Thank you for the introduction, and once again, welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, Council, that's our only delegation, which brings us to E, unfinished business. We have from the Alberni Valley Community Forest Corporation. We have a notice of motion provided from August the 14th, 2017. And Councillor McClellan, do you want to make that motion?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. The Council of the City of Port Alberni support the Alberni Valley Community Forest Corporation Board's retention of earnings for 2017 to be held for the specific purpose of pursuing the acquisition of increased tenure and or cut for the Alberni Valley Community Forest. I have a second or I'll explain.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
We've discussed this previously at council, and the legacy committee met earlier this year and recommended that due to the fact that the forest, the community forest is cut is decreasing, and that's decreasing because we're requesting it to decrease because the trees aren't there to cut. If we keep the cut we have, we won't have a forest in 10 or so years, and that's not exactly sustainable logging. So what we would like to do is see if it's possible to the government has not given us any. They've promised it time and time again, and it hasn't come. See if there is some way we can on our own increase the cut. If not, the money would still be there to come to us as a profit dividend.
Yeah, I have to say, Councillor McClellan, that I fully support the use of any dividends to purchase additional forest land for our community forest and expand it, because you're right. I don't see the provincial government providing any extra land, and I don't see any grants. So it seems to me to be a really realistic use of whatever dividends happen to come our way. It's one way of investing in the opportunities for the future. So I certainly support this motion. Anything else, Council, on the motion? Then the motion the way it is, all those in favor? Carried. City Clerk, from the Alberni-Clackawatt Regional District letter, we have a report dated August 23rd from the City Clerk requesting direction of Council regarding a request from the ACRD, which was dated at the end of July, July 26th, to apply for funding from the Alberni Valley Community Forest Legacy Fund for completion of the Alberni Valley Regional Airport Expansion Project. So there are two motions there, and Councillor Paulson, I wonder if you want to make the first motion.
That the report dated August 23rd, 2017, from the City Clerk be received.
Seconder?
Second.
All those in favor of receiving the letter? Carried. And the next item, the next part of the motion, in terms of what we would do with that request. Councillor Paulson, would you like to make that motion?
That the letter from the Alberni-Clackawatt Regional District dated July 26, 2017, requesting to apply to the Alberni Valley Community Forest Legacy Fund for additional funding for the completion of the Alberni Valley Regional Airport Expansion Project be received and the request denied.
Is there a seconder for that?
Second.
Any discussion, Council? Councillor Washington?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. How much money was the regional district looking for?
$350,000.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor McClellan?
Yeah, and we could also maybe just mention that we right now are not taking any uptakes or intakes for the legacy fund. There's a bit of money in it, but at this moment, it's not, no advertising.
Okay, thank you. Anything else, Council? Then I'll, on the motion, all those in favor? Carried.
Mr. Mayor, there is a second part to the report, and certainly with the decisions that Council has made thus far, there's certainly no rush to it, but we did review the terms of reference for the Legacy Committee, and we're just looking for a bit of direction, I guess. If the committee is going to continue in the fashion that it has been, then we should probably update the terms of reference, because the way they read right now kind of indicates that maybe they've served their purpose. And if Council intends that the committee continues, which I think they probably do, then we should take a look at the terms of reference. But given the decisions that Council's just made, there certainly doesn't seem to be a big rush for that.
Right.
We should look at it at some point.
So we do need to give some direction, but you're right, there isn't a huge rush, but we need to give some direction as a Council for that. So, Councillor McClellan?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I notice on here it seems to be a bit confusing to me for a while, but I figure there's another set of motions there, and I would just like to make one of them, if I may. I would move the staff be directed to rewrite the terms of reference of the Alberni Valley Community Forest Committee so the committee will serve indefinitely at the pleasure of Council for the City of Port Alberni, and the composition remains the same. If I have a seconder, explain that.
I'll second that.
So my understanding of what the terms of reference were weren't exactly what I read here, but I'm going by my memory, and I'm not promising that that's 100% accurate. I do remember a big debate about a few parts of it, but I think the best way to do it, and whatever way is makes it legal, that we set the committee up to be an indefinite committee, no ending to it. But at some point, the council, future council, may say they don't want to do it anymore. Then they've got every right to make a motion saying that's over now, and thank you very much. And I believe that's what this motion says, and that's what's intended to say anyway. It will serve indefinitely at the pleasure of the Council of the City of Port Alberni.
Okay. Any further discussion? Councillor Washington and then Councillor Alaman.
Does the committee still want to continue doing it, or are they tired or want to give it up? Or because, I mean, like we said, January 2016, at which time the council will decide. But I'm just wondering if they've done as good as they can and they want to get out.
I think, like, we've got two city reps, two from the board of directors, two from the regional district, and one the mayor appoints from the city at large. And the only one I haven't heard from is Ken McRae, who's the city at large, and I haven't known him to quit anything. So I guess if the mayor reappoints him, the mayor reappoints him. That's up to him.
Thank you. Councillor Alaman?
Yeah, mine was sort of along the same lines. I would assume that as we redo, or as staff redoes the terms of reference, there would be some sort of provision in there for it, any kind of turnover in membership of the committee. I don't know how it's set up now, so whether there was that built into it in the
usually a 2-year term.
Yeah.
Usually.
Yeah. So that would be the same in this committee as well. Would be a 2-year term. Is that kind of what we would lean towards?
Since this committee was established, Mr. Mayor, I believe the committee members have never changed. So we would certainly look at that. And, you know, it's whatever council wishes.
Okay. Councillor Minions?
Thank you. Similar to that, I was just going to say, I think it's important on any committee to have turnover within the members. So I would, if we're going to rewrite the terms of reference, and I'm not sure exactly what they are now either, but I think it's important to note that in there so that we can get new people involved as the years go by.
Thank you. Anything else, Council? Then on the motion, all those in favor? Carried. Okay. Bob Daly Stadium track. We have a verbal report providing information regarding the surface of Bob Daly track in response to a question at the August 14th regular meeting. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So Rob Goodrow, our park supervisor, and myself met on Saturday with a representative from the installation company, and we walked the track and reviewed the state of the track. I then didn't receive an email since after that meeting, have received an email from them essentially indicating that they will be here in September and they will repair the north end, the full lane, and by when they committed to being repairing is they will grind that surface off, reseal, and then reseal that undercoat and then float another coat and repaint as necessary. For that whole north end, for the first full lane, which is where the most severe deterioration is occurring. They will also, at that same time, do further repairs that will be identified by our park superintendent, and that we will be, city staff will be on site to identify those and also keep an eye on the repair work, and that work is to be completed this September.
And
we will continue to follow up with them to ensure that it does.
And is it at their cost?
Yes, under the warranty.
Okay, thank you. Councillor McClellan?
Yeah, I guess that it's under warranty and they're paying is good. I guess my question is, and I don't know if anyone knows the answer, when the warranty runs out, then what? Is this going to fix it for like it's supposed to be, or are we going to be patching, and whoopsie, warranty all gone. Is that a problem, or am I worried about nothing?
One of the reasons why we were strongly pushing for this work to be done this fall is the warranty essentially has another year to go. So we'll be able to see how this work that they are doing goes through the winter and still have all next year to observe. And what they're proposing to do, especially on the north side of the track where it's the worst part, is not a simple patch. It's to grind down that whole lane, reseal the undersurface, and then refloat it and repaint. So it's not a simple patchwork. But that being said, it's another reason why we pushed very hard to have it done in September to ensure that we have another full year of our warranty left to ensure that the work is still holds up.
Okay, thank you. Anything else, Council? Councillor Washington?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Is this company, do they deal with issues like this all the time? Or I guess we don't, can't really find that out, but I'm just wondering if they have the same reoccurring problem in other communities, or is there any way to find out that maybe they have a problem with something there in the system?
Not aware whether there's been other issues with, I mean, as with any product, I'm certain there's a certain amount of wear and tear, but this is within warranty. It's clearly not meeting the terms of the product that we need, and we're asking them to fix it.
Councillor Alemany?
I'm only speaking maybe on behalf of Mr. Anderson. I see him writing furiously over there. Maybe we could invite him and see if he has any questions, if that's okay with the chair.
Mr. Anderson, has this answered your questions?
Well, I do have two short ones.
Okay. Do you want to come up to the lectern there, and if you've got a couple of quick questions?
I think it's not a knowledge from my previous discussion.
Then, Mr. Anderson, we'll just have a quick vote from council just to make sure that everybody supports that. So, Councillor Alemany?
Make a motion.
Yes.
To have Mr. Anderson come.
No, second
council.
That.
All in favor? Carried. There we go.
First question, who was the company that installed it?
It's called Marathon Surfaces.
And I guess the ideal time for the repairs would have been in the weather we're having. I don't know what September is going to bring. And the reason I mention that is that's the same area that really started to deteriorate prior to us resurfacing it. And it's very clear, at least to me, and I know a little bit about drainage, that there's a water problem there. And just repairing the membrane by itself may not resolve the problem, the ongoing problem. There's a drainage problem that causes that to deteriorate in that one section. And that should be, I would hope we would look at that in depth before we laid another surface down.
I would imagine our parks supervisor or manager would be on top of that.
We've identified that area, and we will be doing some work to ensure that the drainage is resolved.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, you sit right there.
Okay, Council, that brings us, thank you very much for that, Mr. Smith and Mr. Anderson. Brings us to staff reports. Our first staff report is on accounts. Councillor Washington, do you want to move that?
Certainly. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the certification of the Director of Finance dated September 5, 2017 be received, and checks numbering 139477 to 139625 inclusive, and payments of account totaling $1,125,637.07 be approved.
I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. And also, Councillor Washington, the Audit Committee minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the minutes from the August 14, 2017 Audit Committee meeting, the responses to questions arising from the meeting dated August 15th, the quarterly analysis of mayor and council travel and convention expenses ending June 30th, 2017, the financial statements ending June 30, 2017, the vendor check register reporting ending August 3rd, 2017, and late item G investments report be received.
Seconder?
Second.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? You have some questions?
On page 49 to 50, there's a lot of paving and so on. It's 100% not done. It looks to me, or is that 100% done? And then some of it looks like it's been overspent, and maybe some money's been redirected, and I missed that or something. Can anyone answer that? It's on page, this line number 485, 404, and so on. Down to 435, I guess, and then.
I don't have that information directly in my hand, so we can get the details and certainly get back to the council on that.
Yeah, just got 550,000 and 551, I guess, is a total of those three numbers. But did we overspend, underspend, or it just doesn't seem to add up in any way here.
Thank you.
We can certainly clarify that and find out that information for council.
Okay, thank you. Anything else, council? Then on the motion, all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And council, that brings us next to the monthly report from the McLean Mill Society. And I believe that the executive director, Deanna Boatwens, here with her statement. And I'll turn this over to you, Ms. Boatwens.
Good evening, council and Mr. Mayor. Thank you for having me again. I really don't have much of a report other than I would love to be here to answer any questions given that we have submitted late with our events report. You have our financials in front of you, acknowledging that they are 1 month behind. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to tell you many good things that we're doing.
Councillor Sobey?
Yeah, just one question, and thank you for the late report there. I had a chance to go through it. Do we have the financial report for the month of June?
It should be right in your package.
Is it? Where is it? In that package. Okay, great. And that's going to be for public?
Yes.
And all that?
That one wasn't late. It was just the events report that was late.
Okay. And a correspondent for the late item, that's going to be at public view. It will be attached to the minutes.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor, the monthly report?
Yes, including the late.
It won't be attached to the minutes, but we could attach it to the agenda. It certainly is a public document.
Very happy to have it.
The financial statements are all included in the agenda package.
Okay, I just want to make sure everybody has access to it. Okay, thank you very much.
You're
and
very welcome.
By the way, great work you're doing up there.
Thank
it's
you.
It's amazing. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Paulson.
Just looking through on your budget and budget year to date and stuff. Couple figures are low, but would you attribute that to the late start, basically, that we got started there? Or?
I would attribute that to a couple things. Definitely the late start didn't help us, and the fact that we're running a half-capacity train. So if you give me exactly what you're referring
well,
to, I can tell you
actually,
more specifically.
The three items that come up, obviously, is train tickets,
yeah.
food sales, and general store sales. And I gather that those figures will gather momentum as we get closer to the end of the year, but
yes,
they're just for example, the general store sales budget was 32,000. Year to date is 8216.
Show me what you're looking at, and I will also look at.
Mind
it.
You, if you look at the expense side, you're down on revenue, but you're also down on expense. So
very
good girl.
Much so. We've been keeping an eye on everything. Definitely you'll see a little bit less in terms of our revenue, but our expenses are significantly less as well. We've been very, very cognizant of our spend on every single area. We definitely picked up momentum a little bit slowly because of our late start. We didn't actually get going until mid-June. You're going to see a significant bump in August. August was very busy on all areas. I'm so proud of our food services, for instance. Just in general, the way it was handled, I think, as the word spread on what we're doing. There was also a few other things I think that is worth noting in that we created the opportunity for children under 11 to ride the train for free, which allowed, I think, a significant bump in families visiting us. So that would decrease our revenue slightly, but it definitely increased our exposure and rekindled the affection for the property. And that was one of our aims for this year. So I really am quite excited to come to you in a month's time when we have our full summer report. I think everyone's going to be quite pleased.
I have to say I've told you personally, but I want to make sure that council hears the same, which is that when we had the shaker over the three-day weekend that also included Thunder in the Valley, to me that was a whole additional demographic that hadn't been spending a lot of time at that mill or that mill site. That kept making a lot of comments about how cool it was to go out there. And you know, and they literally put in collectively thousands of hours to improve that site. So sure. Those sorts of events really help improve the site, but more importantly, create the next generation commitment to using that site and helping it become whatever it can become to benefit the community. So well done, and the more that we include as wide a range of people as we possibly can at that site, the more committed the entire community is to full use of that site.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We completely agree.
I would like to see the site increase in size somehow, if there's some way for us to figure out how to do that. But I guess we'd have to get Island Timber to come on as a corporate sponsor in a different way. So
we also agree with that.
Okay, thank you very much. Anything else, Council? Then Councillor Sylvia, do you want to move receipt of that report?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. That the monthly report and financial statements to July 31st, 2017 from the Executive Director of the Mill Society be received.
All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And Council, we have next the status report on page 80.
Mr. Mayor, we have a late item.
I'm sorry.
It's a report from the Director of Development Services and the Director of Finance regarding an award of tender for renovations to portions of Gyro Youth Center.
Thank you.
And there is a motion on the screen if Council wants to look at that one.
Who's able to speak to the actual renovations that are going to happen? Mr. Smith, you are?
Sure, I can give Council a quick summary. So this is part of the larger recreation park project that is 50% funded through grant and was approved in the city's 2017 budget. And the portion of this work involves renovations mainly to the basement of Gyro Youth Center as well as the balcony. In my mind, one of the biggest things is addition of washrooms that will be accessible to the outside. There's no current washrooms for the general public using that park, so that, in my mind, will be a big improvement to the overall park. The boardroom will be renovated, and that will bring it up to a standard where it could be rented out to generate revenue. There is significant electrical and fire alarms work that will bring them both up to safety and fire code. And the back balcony rebuilt. It's in quite poor condition. It's unsightly, but it's also unsafe. So that will be a big part of it. And as part of that, they will partition underneath back balcony to provide storage areas for sports associations that use that park, such as pickleball and lacrosse, as well as general aesthetic improvement to the facility. We did have four contractors go to the site visit for this project. We did only have one. We only did receive one bid. That bid was within what the expected budget was and was met all the qualifications. It's from a local contractor. I do apologize for this being a late item. It did close towards the end of last week, and it is time sensitive in order to try and get the work completed in order to meet the grant's timelines. And I'd be pleased to try and answer any further questions.
Councillor McClellan?
Yeah. All that work, I think, has been a little overdue getting done, and I'm glad we're doing it. But I do have two questions. One, does that mean you're changing the tennis court to pickleball?
No, there's already been a new pickleball court added.
Okay, I haven't been up there lately, but it's good that you're putting washrooms in. All the old guys who take their grandkids up there will say thank you. And why do you think there's only, do you have any idea why there's only one bid? I mean, I always get nervous when that happens.
I can't say for certain, other than I am aware all the contractors are very busy on a lot of projects. If I had to guess, that would be my guess. It was well within the expected budget that our staff had considered for this project.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Paulson and then Councillor Alleman.
Just a quick comment for those of you who haven't been by the park. The lacrosse courts are virtually finished, I believe, and they look spectacular. The new outdoor basketball court, I believe, is finished. and I think they've had a look at the stands at the ball field, and things are looking pretty good there too, from what I understand. So it's a great area. Just drive by, because it's there's going to be a lot more outdoor lacrosse and ball hockey going on. Fix that surface. No more broken legs in there.
Councillor Alemany.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And just along the same lines, maybe a request for a report for the next meeting, if possible, just knowing that this is sort of a portion of the larger project. It'd be nice to know what has been done and what is left to come, just for general information.
We can certainly bring a summary report to council once it's completed, for sure.
So you said this is time sensitive. So when are you expecting this work to be started?
If council grants approval, it'll happen very shortly, and looking to be completed towards the end of October.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Councillor Sobey?
That the report dated September 5th, 2017 from the Director of Development Services and Director of Finance be received in council and council for the City of Port Alberni award tender RFT-028-17 Renovate Gyro Youth Center Project 317404 to the lowest bidder, Adelhart Concrete Plus, in the amount of $78,000 plus tax.
I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. Thank you, Council. And Council, that brings us to our current status report. Any questions, Council? Councillor Paulson?
Just on item number 9, and it's under report recommending alternate truck routes other than 3rd Avenue and Anderson, and I'd sure like to see movement on something moving forward here, but truck counts to be undertaken on primary routes and alternate routes to be considered to support further discussion with Port Alberni Port Authority and Western Forest Products. I'm wondering where we're at with the number 19. Just wondering where we're at with the truck counts, if there's been any other discussions with the Port Authority and Western Forest Products. It's a project I'd love to see get them rocking.
Mr. Smith?
We have recently received a cost estimate to undertake that truck count work, and I'll be following that up with the CAO upon his return.
Okay. Anything else, Council? Then, Councillor Minions, do you want to move for receipt?
Move receipt of the current month status report.
Second that, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor? Carried. Thank you. And there are no manager's monthly reports this month, which then brings us to G, bylaws. The first bylaw for council's consideration is the portion of lane closure adjacent to 4383 Latham Road and removal of dedication bylaw number 4945. The notice of council's intent to adopt the bylaw has been advertised. And
Mr. Mayor, we do have the one late item there as well, and it's a letter that we received today from Chris Redlack suggesting that closure of the lane would make lot number 27, which is at 4375 Latham, inaccessible from Latham as the property does not have a driveway and all the parking is at the back. He states an alleyway is better than private property. There may be members in the audience as well that might wish to speak on this issue, Mr. Mayor, before Council considers the bylaw.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody wish to bring this to our attention? Any concerns? There's a... Yes, sir.
Yeah,
would you come forward, please?
Hi, Ben Beanecamp. That's my daughter and my son-in-law's property. And the house is exactly 5 feet away from the property line. And that alley is encroached into their property. There's probably 8 or 10 popular trees on the alley, which is city property, which are about 120 feet tall, which he wants to be able to prune down, so it will not be basically a hazard against his house. That's why he wants to buy the property. As far as the alleyway, there's two other accesses into that back.
Yep.
And it makes it for a very tight corner, and for those people coming in through there, and it's very dangerous for them coming out of the alley onto the Latham because of the S-bends right there.
So let me just make sure I understand your concern. You're not opposed to selling the alley?
No, I'm all for buying it on behalf of my daughter and her husband that own the property.
Okay, so we you're now suggesting that we have a second group that's interested in buying, a party that's interested in purchasing this alley?
No.
It's the same.
My daughter and my son-in-law are out of the country.
Right.
So they asked if I could speak on their behalf.
Okay, gotcha now. Now I know whether you're on the west side of the alley or the east side of the alley. Now I gotcha.
Yeah. I'm on the east. They're on the east side of the alley.
Okay.
Yeah, they own. They have, yeah.
And England's a long ways away from here, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So... is there any, if the alley is sold, does that in any way infringe on their ability to access their property, either from Latham or from the rest of the alley that would exist behind that? Does that infringe in any way?
No, there's two other accesses into that, in the backside of everybody's property.
Yeah.
They just want it. There's basically a gas line under it, so you cannot build anything on top of that. It's just so that basically it's very tight in there. It's only 14 feet wide, and the trees encroach about 4 feet. So now, right now, they're right up against, basically cars coming through are right up against their house. So that's what they're trying to stop.
Right, okay. Any other questions, Council? Mr. Smith, do you want to make a point?
Well, just for clarification, I believe this gentleman is representing the people who wish to purchase the land.
That's right. Correct.
And yeah. Add it to their property.
I got that figured out.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor McClellan.
Mr. Mayor, I'd make the motion that the portion of road closure adjacent number 4383 Latham Road and removal of dedication bylaw number 4945 be now finally adopted, signed by the mayor and clerk, sealed with the corporate seal number 4945.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Thank you, Council.
Mr. Mayor, can I just ask that the letter from Mr. Redlach is received?
And a motion to receive Mr. Redlach's letter?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
All in favor? Carried. Thank you. Council, the next bylaw we're asked to consider is under places of public worship, exemption bylaw amendment number 2, bylaw number 4946. This is cleaning up some past situation that we've been dealing with now or asked our staff to deal with for more than a year. So, Councillor Alemany, would you make that motion for us, please?
That places of public worship exemption bylaw amendment number 2, bylaw number 4946, be now finally adopted, signed by the mayor and clerk, sealed with the corporate seal, and numbered 4946.
Second that, Mr. Mayor.
Any discussion, Council? Councillor McClellan?
Just curious which church or organization this is.
City Clerk?
Mr. Mayor, it's the Khalsa Dewan Society Church on 12th Avenue, which is now under new ownership and is no longer operating as a church. Therefore, it will become fully taxable next year.
Right. Okay. All those in favor? Carried. And we have a summary report, Council. August 17th, meeting of the Advisory Planning Commission is provided for Council's consideration. The following application, and it's a development application on Regina Avenue, so Regina and Rex. And Council wishes, I'm sure Mr. Smith is here and he can answer any questions that you may have. And Councillor Minions, are you able to make this motion?
That the summary report of the August 17th, 2017 meeting of the Advisory Planning Commission be received and all recommendations accepted.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
Question, Councillor McClellan?
Yeah, I'm a bit confused looking at the diagram here where it's got the two lots they want to make into one lot and call that one and two family dwelling. Does that mean he's going to keep that building and two families are going to move in? He kind of hinted that when he put his name on the church. I'm just wondering.
Okay. So what the applicant is proposing, the existing, the former church building occupies both lots 10 and 11.
Yeah.
He's proposing to renovate that into his own single family dwelling residence. And lot 12, which is mostly a vacant parking lot currently, if the rezoning was to go forward, would be available for someone to potentially build a single family house or a duplex. It would be large enough to potentially build a duplex as well. So that's essentially what he's proposing. We are requesting that a site survey be completed prior to a public hearing, as the building appears to be too close to some setbacks, and council might need to consider variances as well. But that's what's proposing. He wishes to renovate the former church into a single family dwelling, and then lot 12, which is essentially a vacant lot, could potentially be developed for either a single family house or a duplex in the future.
Okay, and that's what I heard. I just wondered how it was going to work. It'd be interesting to see. That's going to be quite a mansion on retro.
We will require him to apply for a building permit to get residential occupancy on the church building. Mm-hmm.
And one other question. I noticed in his conditions, one of them was, just don't touch them trees on the boulevard. Thou shalt not cut them down without permission from the city or something. Just to make a note, the most of the trees on that road are dead and dying. So probably good to have a look at them. And I know the one in front of my house, which is just up the road from here, there is pretty much less than half of it is still, half the branches are still alive. And one of the ones just down by where the church was actually broke in half 2 years ago because it just died down. So just a comment. I think we should be looking at that.
Okay. Any other question, Council? Then Councillor Alemany, do you, on the motion, all those in favor? Carried, thank you. And then Councillor Alemany, there's the next part of this.
That's the zoning bylaw amendment?
Yes.
That zoning bylaw amendment number 25, 4850 Regina Avenue, Knutson, bylaw number 4948 be now introduced and read a first time.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried.
That zoning bylaw amendment number 25, 4850 Regina Avenue, Knutson, bylaw number 4948 be read a second time.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And also from the Director of Development Services, we have zoning bylaw amendment number 23, 4465 and 4453 Ninth Avenue, Poirier. Bylaw number 4937 can be seen on page 100. And we have the report dated August 23rd from this Director of Development Services recommending adoption of bylaw number 4937. Councillor Alemany, do you want to make that motion, please?
That zoning bylaw amendment number 23, 4465, and 4453 Ninth Avenue, Poirier. Bylaw number 4937 be now finally adopted, signed by the mayor and clerk, sealed with the corporate seal and numbered 4937.
Is there a seconder?
Second, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. Okay, Council, that brings us then to correspondence for action. The first bit of correspondence is from the Advisory Traffic Committee meeting. We have a copy of the minutes of August 2nd, 2017. With recommendations to council. Councillor Paulson, do you want to make those motions first, please?
Sure, that council for the city of Port Alberni direct staff to investigate improvements to the intersection of Gertrude Street and Southgate Road.
Is there a seconder?
I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
And council, You'll recall that on that one, we received a letter of concern from several citizens who live and work in that area, and they're concerned about pedestrian safety crossing Johnson at Southgate. On the motion, all those in favor? Carried.
And that Council for the City of Port Alberni directs staff to investigate improvements to the intersection of Argyle Street and Anderson Avenue.
I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
And is there there's an issue with vehicle safety crossing there? Is that the issue?
It's a strange intersection because you've got four lanes that empty into two or two coming up into four lanes. There seems to be confusion at the intersection, who has right-of-ways. It's just kind of a weird, as we looked at it through Google Maps and stuff, it's a weird layout, so maybe staff could just have a look at it.
Perfect. Okay. On the motion then, all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And we have a letter dated August the 11th, 2017, from Inspector Hunter requesting the city's support in the implementation of the Block Watch program by encircling and removing erecting or removing Block Watch signs. Councillor Sobey, do you want to make that motion, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. That the letter dated August 11, 2017, from Inspector Brian Hunter requesting city's support in the implementation of the Block Watch program by erecting or removing Block Watch signs be received and the request approved.
Is there a seconder?
Second, Mr. Mayor.
Any discussion, Council? All those
how do you,
in.
How do you sign up?
How do you sign up?
For the Block Watch, it's through the detachment. They'll have application forms or just see the community policing officer in charge. And I know at the community policing office, they're going to have applications there. But for more detail, until they get this all organized, and there's been a lot of demand in the community to have these Block Watch organized. And so it's a lot of applications are going to be through the detachment or the community policing office.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Councillor McLennan?
No problem. I was just going to make the same comment, Dennis.
Okay. On the motion then, all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And under proclamations, we have an annual proclamation for the Port Alberni Toy Run. We have an email dated August the 15th requesting the week of September 18th to 24th be a special week for them. So, Councillor McLennan, do you want to make that motion?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, the letter dated August 15, 2017, for the Port Alberni Toy Run requesting the week of September 18th to 24th, 2017, proclaimed as Toy Run Week and Canada's most rider-friendly community week. In Port Alberni, we received and the week proclaimed as requested.
I'll second that request, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor? Carried. And from the Fire Prevention Office, Port Alberni Fire Detachment, Councillor Minions, do you want to make that motion?
That the letter dated August 21st, 2017, from the Port Alberni Fire Department requesting that October 8th to 14th, 2017, be proclaimed as Fire Prevention Week in Port Alberni be received and the week proclaimed as requested.
And I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
All those in, Councillor McLennan?
Yeah, I think this is great and all, but I was kind of hoping that maybe some of the fire department would be here to advertise it. I'm not sure if I heard it correctly, but on the local news the other day, I heard a comment that I thought they said that the Port Alberni Fire Department was just starting to give out fines for illegal fires. I'm hoping they didn't just start and they've given a lot out if they've had found some illegal fires. I'm wondering how that's been going.
There were illegal fires in Cherry Creek. I know the fines were.
Well, there were several. I hope they caught them all. But
yeah.
But if there was some in Port Alberni, I was wondering as well.
Certainly the fire, you know, there was a fire at down Roger Creek Park just behind the multiplex. So it caused great consternation. However, on the motion, all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And we have also a request from Community Living Month. We have a letter dated August 18th from the Port Alberni Association for Community Living requesting the month of October to be proclaimed as Community Living Month. Councillor Paulson, do you want to make that motion?
The letter dated August 18, 2017, from Port Alberni Association for Community Living, requesting that the month of October be proclaimed as Community Living Month in Port Alberni be received and the month be proclaimed as requested.
Second that, Mr. Mayor.
All those in favor?
Mr. Mayor, there is also an invitation there to a celebration they're having for their 60th anniversary in town.
From the Community Living?
Yeah, it's the next page down. Page 11. Yeah, some kind of big gala. And it looks like quite a party on September the 30th. So maybe we should just make note of it at the next meeting. It'll be plenty of time to remind everybody.
Okay, thank you. But we voted on the, and it's carried. Thank you. Okay, thank you. And City Clerk, we have some informational correspondence. Could you just review that for Council, please?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, a few items. A letter from Peter and Pat Rushman expressing concern regarding speeding on Bird Street and noise from cars and motorcycles. And that letter has been forwarded to the Advisory Traffic Committee, which next meets in October, I believe. A copy of a letter from the City of Abbotsford advising of a resolution for consideration at the 2017 UBCM Convention regarding the Abbotsford Police Department's report on the opioid crisis, a case for prevention. RCMP Municipal Policing Agreement expenditures to July 31st, 2017. Trinity Church and Alberni Valley United Church invites the Mayor and Council to the second of four events that they're organizing, Building Bridges Through Understanding the Village, which will be held on September 24th from 1 to 4 p.m. Civic Info, a letter inviting the Mayor and Council to attend a one-day workshop hosted by the Fraser Valley Regional Library and Civic Info on October 25th. At the Cascade Casino Resort in Langley. And lastly, an email from Gary Lajeunesse expressing concern regarding the air quality in the valley.
Thank you, City Clerk. Councillor Washington, do you want to move receipt of that?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the informational correspondence items numbered 1 through 6 be received and filed.
Your seconder?
Second.
All those in favor?
Carried.
There is no report from in camera, so that brings us to council reports. And the first one is from me. Council, there's a few items I want to bring to your attention. Put them in order of the most recent one, and just take a few of the items that I've been in to highlight that I've been involved in the last little while. September 4th, I was involved in the salmon weigh-in from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. On the last Monday of Salmon Festival. And Councillor Washington, thank you very much for all your hard work on that. It went extremely well and lots of positive comments about that. And it was great, extremely busy during that time. A lot of fish and therefore a lot of very happy fishers out there on the, and most of the fish came right from the harbor. Didn't have to go very far to get that. Those big fish, that was great. September the 3rd, I was at the Antique Truck and Machinery Show in behind the old arena and presented the Mayor's Choice Award. And it was a difficult choice, but in the end it went to a gentleman who lives out on Faber Road, and he has organized this entire presentation of historic vessels on the coast, and they are complete right down to the tiniest little detail, even to the piece of orange garbage on top of the garbage can that he had seen in one of the photographs. So it's amazing, and they all work, and they're all remote controlled. So he and his friends were there just having a great time. So were the kids that were watching it. September the 2nd, I was out in Euclid in the evening for a presentation by Chief Clarence Louie from the Osoyoos First Nation. Great presentation on the importance for economic development on First Nations reserves and how in his reserve people are They have more jobs than they have people. And everybody's working. And he says, we make our own money. We don't ask for money. We make our own money. And that's, in his opinion, that's the way it should be done. So it's a very interesting perspective for people who are in attendance to hear. As well, on September 2nd, I was at the Salmon Festival opening. It was great, perfect weather, wasn't too windy, nice and warm, sun out, it's good. On August 26th, I was at the Thunderbird building for the Euclid First Nation Satellite Office grand opening. It was wonderful for that nation that they were able to open a satellite office here in Port Alberni to service approximately 40% of their members that reside in Port Alberni. And this coming Saturday, don't forget, Council, that it's the Fall Fair Parade. And for the first time, I believe, the Mayor of Cumberland is going to be attending this year. And she's going to be riding in a Model T, driven by Vic Laughlin. And I'm going to be in a different Model T, driven. It has the Arlington Hotel on the side, so you'll be able to see me. And it's quite the... quite the vehicle, incredibly well restored for both of them. And if you know Vic Laughlin, you know that anything he does is top notch, just the same way with this other gentleman. So that's my report. I move acceptance of that report, Council.
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
And all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And Council, our next report from the Regional District, Councilor McClellan.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. There wasn't that long of a meeting at the regional district, but one thing that stood out to me, at least, was the request from the Fisheries Commission for one member for all of Vancouver Island to have a say in the new fisheries treaties that are coming up. And it just doesn't seem that that is something that Vancouver Island should be accepting, because I think they were offering it to Victoria, if I remember correctly, where Victoria was butting in and wanting it quickly, where all the regional districts that are up the coast, who have a lot of people that make their living on fisheries, were being neglected. So we did write a letter asking for more. I guess we'll see what happens when that comes. And I think that's about all that was of actual value out of the open meeting, Mr. Mayor. There'll be some in the in-camera meeting that will be made public at the next one, and I'll announce it at our next meeting.
Okay, thank you.
And I'll move that report.
And I'll second it. All those in favor? Carried. And then that brings us to councilors' reports. Our last meeting was several weeks ago, Council, so who knows what people have been involved in. And let's start with you, Councilor Washington.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a couple of quick highlights. We did our fourth annual Our Town at Harbor Quay on the 22nd of August, which winds up the Our Town program for Port Alberni for 32 years, celebrating free family fun. And I'd just like to thank the Parks and Rec staff. The young ladies there do an awesome job, and we couldn't do it without them. Fast forward to last weekend, Tai Landing Salmon Festival number 46. I think we've done good. the reports I get, the people that have stopped me to say, I like it, I get more, 300 more likes to one dislike, so I think we'll probably have to figure out to get a new place to play at Tai Landing. Congratulations to Nanaimo's Jeff Addison for his 34.5 that held on from Saturday right to closing ceremonies and netted him $15,000. I'd also like to thank Councillor Solvay for doing his duty in the beverage garden with all those nice young ladies and stuff. I mean, he looked like he was having a tough time there, so glad you enjoyed yourself, Councillor. Weigh-ins totaled 2,215 pieces, so that's a pretty good derby for us. More details will be on the Salmon Festival webpage. I just got some emails during the meeting that says that stuff has been forwarded to our webmaster, so hopefully by tomorrow we'll have all the hidden weights and all the awards on there. And just to close, congratulate Ian Thomas. He won the Egan Matheson Award for the Volunteer of the Salmon Festival. Ian showed up the first night on Monday to help the Kiwanis, branched over to help the Salmon Festival, and was probably one of the last guys down at Tai Landing this afternoon when they finished up at about 5 o'clock. So it looks like we've never even been there. So again, congratulations and volunteers. The mayor said that I can't say enough about how the volunteers got us out of a pickle this weekend. We were struggling about Wednesday, so my darling wife Chris put a plea out, and Port Alberni once again came up and answered. So first of all, thanks Chris, and second of all, thank you Port Alberni, and that's my report.
Thank you. And Councillor Alemany.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. For official business, I was at the Advisory Planning Commission for last month, but that report is in there, so I won't go any further than that. Of course, attended Salmon Festival, did the early morning shift on Sunday morning. It wasn't nearly as busy, although I have to say, the first person to come in, I got there at six, and it took until 9 o'clock before Scott Kenny came running up with a 10-pound fish for the first fish of the day. So that was awesome. But yeah, it was a great event, and I do think it was good down at Tai Landing. It was a lot of fun. The only other thing I wanted to mention, I was at the truck show as well, and I was at the Industrial Heritage Center there. And if the public hasn't already kind of wandered into that center, there's an old train car in there from, I believe, the 1800s that they're restoring. It's a beautiful old car. If you ever go in there, please do. If there's someone in there working on it, they will fill you in on kind of how it all works. The amount of hours that they've poured into that is just incredible, right down to scraping off tiny little bits of wood at a time, and they can always use help. So if you have any inclination, go ahead and do it. The fellow who was there made a great point. He said, you know, if you don't know anything about it, that's okay, because you'll just be joining a bunch of other guys who don't know anything about it either. We'll just figure it out as we go. So please go help if you can. That's it.
Thank you. And Councillor Minions?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No official business. Most of my committees were shut down for August, but I did attend a grand opening and ribbon cutting for a new clothing store uptown called Forever New. It is a used clothing store for women. Councillor Sauvé attended with me, and it was a very good event and just a really good job on them setting up that store. They've done a very nice job. Other than that, I've been attending a ton of great events this summer, and I've had a lot of people say to me, especially new people to the community, just recognizing how many events we have on here, and recognizing that most of those events are put on solely by volunteers. So I think it's fantastic that we have such a strong volunteer base in this community, and just want to say thank you to all those people out there who have volunteered their time. Other than that, I've just been enjoying a leisurely, relaxing summer, something like that.
Well, good for you. Thank you, Councillor Minions. Councillor Paulson.
Once again, a shout out to our town, and had 8 of our Bulldog hopefuls down at the world's only floating ball hockey game, which was a blast. It was blowing like crazy. The Port Authority's out there getting all the balls out of the water for us. Shameless shout out here is the Bulldog season opener is September the 8th in Nanaimo. So we have a ticket exchange with them, and we sold every one of the tickets. We have a huge contingent going down, so if anybody wants to go down and make a lot of noise, sit where it's cool and cheer on the Bulldogs, it's great. And through a change in legislation this year, I had a once in a lifetime good things happen to you, and I was asked by my nephew and his fiance to read their wedding vows. And the change in legislation now is actually you can do the legal paperwork off-site, and basically you can ask an aunt, uncle, dad, mom, whatever, to read the vows. And it was just a huge honor to do that for them. And it was a great day. We were outdoors, and so if anybody asks you, you can actually do the vows for your relatives now. So thank you. That's my report.
Okay. And I believe September 15th, I'm dropping the puck at the Bulldogs game.
I'm sure you will.
Yeah.
Get you some spikies, right?
Okay.
Nobody in there as well as spikies.
Councillor Sobey.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Glad to hear that councillors are able to marry people now, so maybe I'll get into that business.
Maybe we'll just get married.
No. I'll do the marrying. I've been extremely busy in the last 2 weeks. Just like Councillor Minions, my committees are shut down for a couple of weeks. I've been very busy volunteering across town. Unfortunately, because of the weather, a lot of the seniors are just staying inside. So with that said and done, there's one thing. I've been very busy down on Argyle for several illegal dumping, and especially around the Carlson building and so forth. So it's been kind of keeping me busy on a weekly basis. With that said and done, thank you to Councillor Washington for sending out the invite for the Salmon Fest. I had a lot of fun. Spent a couple of days there, and the event was I was worried about the area and all that, but to be honest with you, it was probably the best thing that's ever happened, and everything was so well organized, security, and when I went out, after I finished my shift there, I went out on Citizens on Patrol, and I got to go visit there, and everything was covered, and no events, nothing wrong happened, and I think it's a great asset to the organizers. So I want to extend a big thank you on behalf of council for the sponsors and the organizers and the volunteers. It's just simply amazing, and in the weather and working that. So with that said and done, I do have many events to attend in the next couple of weeks, and I was hoping to make a motion here to cover my travel expenses to see the seniors advocate in Victoria on September 15th. So if I could read this motion.
I think you just gave it.
Yeah, well, I'll make it nice and proper just to make. Request council authorization for travel expense to attend the Office of the Senior Advocate release. It's a release of the result of a landmark residential care survey that a lot of facilities are waiting for, and we want to see what the government's going to be making and into special moves and encouraging for special funding to go towards, and I'm fighting very hard to getting those funds to Port Alberni. So it's on September 15th, 2017, and if someone wants to second it and vote for it, be right.
Okay. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you, Councillor Sobey. All right. And Councillor McLennan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I attended the McLean Mill Society meeting, and seemed to be going well. We've heard a decent report, and I kind of appreciated the comments that I did hear there, that they are not spending more money than they have, and that kind of makes council, I guess, feel a bit more comfortable. Nobody asking for more just yet, at least. And I spend a lot of time in the summer being out of town on weekends and different things, but due to some things that I do, I had an opportunity to meet an awful lot of tourists who are in town and coming from different parts of the world for different things that we have, and they all seem to be at least excited to be here, even though the time I got to see some of them, they were having a bit of a difficulty, but they seem to be all right, and so it was good to me that people are coming here from pretty much everywhere in Canada, and hopefully they not only enjoy their stay, but maybe they'll come back, and some of them might want to live here. So other than that, though, Mr. Mayor, I think that concludes my report, and I'd like to move the acceptance of all these one-off reports from these councillors tonight.
I'll second that, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor? Carried. Thank you.
Great fireworks, by the way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was incredible. Mm-hmm. Absolutely incredible.
Council, under new business, we've titled Solar Energy at City Facilities. As you know, City and Council have been looking at it from a number of different perspectives. what we can do with regarding harvesting solar energy, and certainly this summer has been a great example of how we have a tremendous opportunity here in Port Alberni to do this. I want to reassure council that there's been a lot of work done in the background, and so it's now time to consider this more fully, and let's see what we can do in terms of moving the process forward. So Councillor Alemany's committee has been heavily involved in supporting this initiative. Sorry, I shouldn't say Councillor Alemany's committee. It's the council's committee, but Councillor Alemany is our liaison to that committee. So I'm wondering, Councillor Alemany, do you want to make this motion?
I would be very pleased, and just on the committee, I'm sure when I notify them Thursday at our next meeting, they will be extremely excited to know that this motion, if it passes, will be there. So the motion that the city undertake an RFP process seeking innovative proposals for the supply and installation of solar generation equipment on some or all of the city-owned buildings identified in the 2016 Viridian report.
And I'll second that motion. Councillor Paulson?
Just a refresher for me. What were some of the buildings that were identified?
All of the, yeah, the multiplex, Glenwood, the Industrial Heritage Center, and the Gyro Youth Center, and I think I might be missing one.
City Hall.
City Hall, right. Thanks.
And yeah. The building, I think the building that Donut Shop's in, the Key, right?
Oh, yeah, right, and the Harbor Key, yeah. And the most economically feasible ones were the ones that had the lowest power consumption, so the Glenwood and the Industrial Heritage Center.
Councillor McLemon, and then Councillor Sowie.
Yeah, I guess, is this RFP looking for ideas? And how much are we, is this $100,000 we got budgeted? And to me, I mean, I spent a bit of time since we've gone in looking at this, and there's that place in Nanaimo that's gone totally off the grid. And if we want to do stuff like that, there's an awful lot involved. I mean, the guy just gone wonky, I guess, got mad at the entire free world, and he wasn't going to pay nobody's bill. He's not the first one in some of the neighborhoods I've visited. But, you know, to me, we've got to be cautious that we get the top technology. And I don't really, and I have to be honest, I don't think the technology's there yet to do a building with stuff on the roof. The cost will outweigh any benefits at this point. We'll see what comes in. I'm just hoping that this is just some ideas and so on, that we're not going to commit ourselves to something until we know how good it is.
Okay, so Councillor McLemon, I can respond a little bit to that, and that is that some of the proposals that have been coming our way, or some of the ideas have been coming our way, are at no cost to the city of Port Alberni. They recover their investment over time. And there's other proposals that would involve permitting members of the city to actually purchase shares in such a development, or purchase a portion of the power that would be produced. So, you know, I think we should put the RFP out there and see what comes our way, and then as a council make our decision about what we want to do after we become more knowledgeable about what the possibilities are. Councillor Sobe.
No, I think I got my question answered, but I have the same concerns as Councillor McMillan to the fact that, and I've done a lot of research with the solar paneling when this subject was brought up, and the transition to even do that is very costly. So again, I would like to see the RFPs, and I would like to see what kind of proposals in that, if it's a different entity that's going to be in charge of it and so forth. But what is actually the saving cost to the taxpayers? It all comes down to that. So, you answered my question. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. On the motion then, all those in favor? Carried. Thank you. And council, this brings us to question period. It's an opportunity for public and press to ask questions of mayor and council. Anybody wish? All right, then moving on, move to adjourn.
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
All in favor? Carried. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for attending, everybody.